Hi, everyone, and good evening. My name is Marwan Krady, and I'm the Dean of Northwestern University Qatar. Welcome to this edition of Critical Conversations, where faculty and students from Northwestern University in Qatar reflect on their research, their teaching, and their engagement with the Global South as idea, notion, and experience. Critical Conversations is a series of events under the auspices of the Institute for Advanced Study in the Global South at Northwestern University in Qatar, or IAS at NUQ. The Institute is a student-focused center that produces and promotes evidence-based storytelling focused on the media, histories, cultures, societies of the Global South. In its vision, in its focus, and its ambition, the Institute reflects our distinctive university with our partners, Qatar Foundation and Northwestern University, particularly the Buffett Institute for Global Affairs. We harness traditions from the liberal arts, media, communication, and journalism to forge multidisciplinary and multimodal approaches to knowledge that is both locally relevant and globally resonant. Our core commitments are to amplify NUQ faculty and student scholarship and media making, to boost undergraduate research, to mentor our students who plan to pursue advanced graduate degrees, and to forge pathways to the professoriate. Our core global undergraduate fellowship program is now welcoming its inaugural cohort. Our fellows collaborate, produce multilingual and multimodal research and media making, and organize events like tonight's. Please follow us on Twitter and use the hashtag IIS_NUQ. To meet our objectives, we are fortunate to have a great staff. So let me introduce them to you. Clovis Bergère is our Assistant Director for Research, who joined NUQ from the University of Pennsylvania, where he was Research Director. He will manage and mentor our undergraduate fellowship programs and coordinate student mentorship and advising with faculty. With a PhD in Childhood Studies from Rutgers University, his research examines digital media and youth cultures in Guinea. He has taught at Rutgers, at the University of the Arts, at Penn, and published widely on digital media, politics, and youth. Marina Krikorian is our research manager for programs and projects. She manages all the logistics and special projects at the Institute. She also serves as managing editor of our publications and supports Institute staff in developing and managing collaborations with partners. Before NUQ, Marina worked at Georgetown University in Washington and at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. She holds an MA in Arab and Middle Eastern Studies from the American University of Beirut and a BA in Political Science from the University of California, Berkeley. Global South means many things to many people, and we are not here to impose one definition. Rather, consider these critical conversations an open invitation to engage and deliberate and collaborate about what the Global South means as a world of experience, as a space of knowledge, for a multidisciplinary group of scholars, teachers, living and working in Doha, Qatar. I now invite Clovis Bergère, our Assistant Director for Research, to introduce the panel. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Marwan, for the kind introduction, and welcome everyone to the first of our critical conversations on the notion of the Global South. My job tonight is very briefly to just clarify the format of the discussion and the event. So we'll have the panelists, our three panelists, take turn reflecting for about 5 minutes each on what the notion of what the Global South means to their work, to their teaching, and maybe more personally to their lives. And after this initial 5 minutes, each they then have a conversation between each other. So we have about 15 to 20 minutes allocated for that, you know, critical conversations where they can respond to each other's comments, and then we'll open it up for question and answer from the audience. My second job, which I'm very excited to do, as you know, Dean Krady mentioned, you know, one of the key you know aspect of the Institute for Advanced Study in the Global South is it's to create a student-centered space, and one way we do this is by inviting our our moderator to who is a student at NUQ to come and moderate this session. So let me just introduce Krishna, who is a journalism senior at Northwestern in Qatar. He's the co-president of the Data Science Club. While here, he has served as a managing editor of the student-run online publication, The Daily Q. He is also published in Al Jazeera English and the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting. Krishna is an active student leader on campus. He's served as a student ambassador, admissions diplomat. He was a peer tutor with the Writing Center, as well as a teaching and research assistant. He was recently awarded a summer undergraduate research grant from Northwestern University to pursue his own research interest in media psychology. Krishna will moderate the panel tonight. So without further ado, let me hand over the floor to you, Krishna.
Thank you, Clovis. Welcome everyone to this critical conversation. Without further ado, I want to go ahead and start by introducing our three panelists for today. We have Professors Banu Akdenizli, James Horap, and Marcela Pizarro. Professor Banu Akdenizli is Associate Professor of Communication at Northwestern University in Qatar. She earned her PhD in Media and Communication from Temple University in 2005. Prior to joining NEQ, she worked at the Yeditepe University in Istanbul, Turkey. She formerly worked as a methodologist and analyst for the Pew Research Center's Journalism Project in Washington, D.C. Professor Akdenizli also worked at the research fellow, as a research fellow of the University of Southern California, Annenberg Public Diplomacy Fellow from 2016 to 2018. She's also the editor and contributor of Digital Transformations in Turkey, Current Perspectives in Communication Studies, a book that was published in 2015, author of Toward a Healthier Understanding of Internet Policy Development, The Case of Turkey in 2007, and co-author of Democracy in the Age of New Media, a report on the media and immigration debate 2008. She has also authored book chapters and numerous periodical articles, both in English and Turkish. Professor James Horap is an assistant professor in residence in the liberal arts program, specializing in African world and post-colonial literatures. He received his PhD from the University of Maryland, his MA from the University of Chicago, and his BA from the American University. Before joining Northwestern Qatar in fall 2018, he served as an assistant professor in the Department of English for 4 years at the American University of Beirut. He has also taught at the University of Maryland, Harold Washington College, Wilbur Wright College, and several other universities and colleges. The objects of his scholarship in Africa have been novels, short stories, films, graphic novels, and television programs. But at its core, all of his work considers how specific African people and places in Africa are represented on the continent and beyond. These concerns with how the local travels and global circuits has led him to his current book, Length Projects on African World Literature and Afropolitanism. He has taught courses in African literature, post-colonial literature, world literature, translational literature, the Global South, and gender studies. Finally, our third panelist, Professor Marcela Pizarro, is an assistant professor in residence at NEQ's Journalism and Strategic Communication Program. She is an award-winning journalist who worked as a producer and reporter at Al Jazeera English, both on the ground in Latin America, Washington, D.C., and Doha, and for the Media Critique Show, The Listening Post in London until 2019. Prior to that, she worked for the Associated Press for many years as a producer and video journalist. She holds a BA in Spanish and French from the University of Nottingham and an MA in Hispanics from UCL. She's the recipient of a British Academy Award for a full doctoral scholarship, through which she completed her PhD in 2004 at the University of London. To get us started, I want to ask each of you to take about 5 minutes to explain what Global South means to your work, to your teaching, and your life, and we can get started with Professor Banu. Professor Banu, what does Global South mean to you?
Thank you, Krishna. Thank you, Clovis. Thank you, Marina. And thank you, Dean Crady. It's very exciting to be here. And I'm very happy to be included with such great colleagues as well. When I look at the term Global South, of course, this is a big term. It's an umbrella term. Means many things, non-West, third world, structurally disadvantaged, identified as the other. But my understanding is a little bit beyond, these binary kind of divisions of South and North, poor and rich, developing and developed. A lot of these formulations of, the understanding of the third world, for example, or the developing world where I am coming from, right? And I'll talk about that a little bit later, briefly as well, because Turkey is in such a unique position, for example, such as China, India, or Brazil. But world maps are based on qualitative measurements and, for example, income categorizations. Today, we're all kind of doing better in the sense of statistics. You know, the income levels have risen, but it's also more diverse. So, making the assertion that the North-South dynamic is not here, I don't think is valid, right? In my understanding of the Global South, it's also an imagined kind of a transnational community, which is about kind of challenging dominant voices of the world, especially in politics, and trying to alternate, trying to formulate some alternatives to the existing status quo. So in this sort of imagined transnational community, we also are set to share like a common trajectory and identity, which is in some parts of the world, of course, connected to this post-colonial and post-imperial marginalization. But is this really cohesive? These are some of the things that I always, think about, and I think we should be challenged in a way, because, it is neoliberalism that has increased the burdens of the South. Yes, we should be, the Global South should be, there should be more South-to-South cooperation and communication. But, this, what we can call this philosophy of self-help is a very novel idea, but it does require practice. And it does, I think, in my view, and from the literature that I've been reading about this more and more, it also requires a rethinking of the global institutional structures, right? Because this shouldn't be seen as a subversion of the existing, neoliberal market principles. Turkey, for example, is under pressure, right, from neoliberal globalization, which they have been beneficiaries of, but they also suffer some of the consequences of uneven development, that is structural characteristics of this global capitalism. So Turkey, for example, is part of the G20, is considered upper middle income, it has high human development levels, and is considered a leading middle, but it's quite complex. Because you see, when you look at Turkey, there's a highly developed West and not so highly developed Southeast. This regional gap in Turkey has been a long historical trajectory. But when you look at the numbers, for example, all provinces, right, score higher than sort of in terms of income today, 30 years ago. But the gap between the lowest ranking and the highest ranking position today is actually higher than in the 1990s. So in my opinion, the Global South, I think, challenges the insularity of what we consider Western political science, Western communication studies. It draws on geopolitical processes. And I think it provides for us scholars, intellectuals, and activists, in a way, to examine these specific issues and struggles, both at the national, regional, and transnational level. The divide is present, it's increasing, but this inequality is not just between countries, if it ever was. I think these inequalities are increasingly marked on a smaller scale between and within communities. And I think, my fellow panelists, we'll talk about these a little bit further, but these were just my opening thoughts. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Professor Banu. Now we move to Professor James Horap.
Hi, thank you for having me, Clovis, for the invitation, and Marwan for creating this thing. So I'm really excited to be here and to be a part of the center. So the notion of the Global South, as Banu just said, is expansive. So I'm going to just discuss a few points of entry for me as a literary scholar that hopefully gestures to some the major themes of the Global South and how that informs scholarship and teaching in general, but with the caveat of my positionality as a literary scholar. So a few points that I have that I think are fairly germane, but are more just kind of openings for discussion, I hope. So one, the notion of the Global South has a genealogy, and it's important to keep that in mind. And there are many ways to construct that genealogy, but one of the most important, for in my mind, for academic study, is its relation to notions such as the post-national, cosmopolitan, and related concepts like Afropolitanism that eschew the nation as a unit of comparison. Because the nation, to put it in a very oversimplified way, we'll talk about this later, is often understood to be a colonial construct. Doesn't deny, the Global South doesn't deny the everyday power of the nation, we just check your passport, but aspires to comparison via smaller units, such as linguistic, and tribal, and larger, such as oceanic. Nonetheless, it is meant to at least interrogate the nation as a de facto form, and often to simply disavow the divisions of the world that we have inherited for an epistemology whose ethos, I think, is to shape our knowledge around the places we study, rather than shape the places we study around our knowledge, a la colonial ethnography. We often say that our scholarship and art cross borders, but a Global South methodology not only infers movement via comparison, but also questions the very nature of borders. I also think, and maybe this is debatable, that the Global South isn't necessarily a geography. That is to say, it's not a space as much as a way of knowing, a methodology, if you will. So international development discourse still uses it in that way, but in a lot of the things that I'm involved with in academia, that's not what we mean. So then what does it mean if it's not a space? It means that one could produce work on a non-Western space and still reproduce colonial knowledge constructs. We see this all the time, right? You know, in work on the MENA region in Africa, for example, white saviorism, poverty porn, et cetera, even sometimes from people from those regions. In the same way, it's not a space because the Global South exists in Western countries. We count indigenous peoples as part of the Global South and marginalized peoples such as African Americans and Latinx communities in certain parts of the world as being part of the Global South. So to my mind, it isn't overly useful to confine thinking about the Global South strictly as a place. But I also want to be clear that the Global South is it's not a new concept. That is, it's not an announcement or an arrival, but firmly entrenched in our epistemologies. The groundwork has been laid for decades, most notably, again, my bias in literary studies, but also in cultural studies, media studies. I mean, there is a journal called The Global South out of Indiana University, in which I've actually published something. It's been around for 15 years, and it's a literary studies journal. So this is nothing new. It's not a fad. There are other genealogies that attest to this that clearly link the Global South to the subaltern studies, post-colonialism, and the like, that have sought equitable ways of representing those who have been marginalized. So thinking about it as kind of as new, I think, is problematic. So the two things that I was trying to finish on was a positivist account of what the Global South is, because what it rejects, I think, is a bit more clear and a short anecdote. So unlike colonialism that was inherently narrow and tried to fit everything into its narrow view of the world, the Global South is a concept that is a dynamic framework for the comparison of cultural, economic, and political inequalities beyond state-centric forms. It enacts South-South comparison as lateral solidarities, as a conceptual framework to address places and peoples negatively impacted by capitalist globalization, both past, such as colonialism, and present. So I think that was all kind of very conceptual, and as an academic, I'm interested in the theories and the methodologies. But an example of this that kind of has resonated with me over the years was that when I was a professor at the American University of Beirut, I was the faculty mentor for the African Club, and I curated a screening of African shorts in Beirut. And one of the films, a film called Big Man, has two little boys playing in Nigeria, and it's in the dark in the rooms at night. They're supposed to be asleep, and they're jumping across the beds, and one of them falls, slips, and hits his head, and he's unconscious, and his brother is yelling. And his parents come in, and they rush in, and they go to turn on the lights, and the lights don't come on. And the mother turns to the father and says, well, what about the generator? And then he's like, well, the generator guy said that the generator's down for, you know, for like 2 weeks, and so we can't count on the generator. And so then they get a doctor, and there's candlelight, and doctor screaming the whole time for more light because he's stitching up the boy's head. But in that moment where the parents essentially think that their son is going to die because they don't have electricity to see and the generator doesn't work, the entire audience of people in Lebanon had this moment of kind of air being sucked out of the room, because everyone in Lebanon, whether you're Lebanese or not like me, has been inconvenienced in major and minor ways because the electricity is so unreliable, and because even the backup to the electricity, the generator, the motor, is oftentimes overloaded or can't be accessed or something. And so there was this kind of amazing connection where the Lebanese audience became much better readers, viewers of that film than a Western audience would, because they have this shared experience of these kind of electrical issues. And so for me, there are these explicit political solidarities within the Global South, but there are also these very minor solidarities that are not necessarily like radical political solidarities. And for me, I think these are just as interesting and meaningful as those. And so I'll just end there, and hopefully we can carry on the conversation. Thank you, despite all the theatrics of whatever that was.
Taking over from Jim. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Banu. Good evening, everyone. Great to be here. Thank you, Clovis, Marwan, and Marina for hosting us. It's great to be sharing the space with my colleagues. I was going to try to avoid reading today, but I can't, because this subject makes me emotional. It makes my voice crack, which is okay, because beyond the need for smooth voiceovers, and indeed for facts, statistics, empirical accuracy, journalism and intellectual work is surely about emotion. When it comes to the Global South and my own relationship with the concept, I would start at the beginning, at one beginning. I was born in Valparaíso, Chile, in the southern cone of Latin America in 1972, during the government of Salvador Allende, the first democratically elected socialist president in history. The Allende government was born into a wider Cold War context, both on that continent, in Africa, Asia, the Middle East, where countries who shared histories of colonization coined the term Third World, the term that precedes the Global South, representing revolutionary, anti-capitalist, anti-colonialist political projects. These were utopian times, but in Chile, they were interrupted by a US-backed military coup and a brutal 18-year dictatorship. The iconic image of the presidential palace being bombed by fighter jets on September the 11th, 1973, made news around the world, but censored in Chile. Censored too was the footage of torture, of bodies being thrown into the sea, of missing people, still missing, and of the hundreds of thousands who fled the country, including my own family. This is a story of defeat, but it's always and also a story of solidarity and internationalism for those of us who sought shelter elsewhere, often in the Global North. These are important concepts too in my work. This is also a story that unfortunately does not get old, as most of us here know. My work and my interests have always hovered around this point of origin. I would say that professionally and politically, my North has been the South. And that South multiplies because one has a tendency to look towards other Southern locations and to establish connections with them. I'm not the only one. I worked for Al Jazeera English for 15 years, and many of my colleagues from different regions had similar sensibilities because they had histories marked by the legacies of colonialism and imperialism that informed their neo-colonial, neoliberal presence. For many of us gathered around the channel, this provided what we felt to be a fairly unique space from where we could speak from the South, and about the North, without the story having to be filtered via London, New York, Paris, or Atlanta. This produces a different kind of knowledge. It has critical energy, and it often sees, films, and feels differently. We will know that the South is not just a literal geographical location, as my colleagues have already mentioned. There is a global South in the North, as many in the North will attest. Marxist historian, and please allow me to quote Stuart Hall, who once said, "People like me who came to England in the 1950s have been here for centuries. Symbolically, we've been here for centuries. I am the sugar at the bottom of the English cup of tea. I am the sweet tooth, the sugar plantations that rotted generations of English children's teeth. There are thousands of others beside me that are the cup of tea itself." As a journalist, I've always had the global South in my mind in terms of my interlocutors. These are the people I imagine I'm talking to about subjects like the politics of representation post 9/11, the Arab Spring, the journalism, and the fate of Julian Assange, the representation of migrants in the media, the structural racism, sexism, classism of the media itself. The same goes for the classroom and this university. For me, this space represents a potential for difference, not a copy of the original, but a production of knowledge and experience that interrupts the North to South flow. As a whole, for me, the global South emerges as a strategic concept. It might resist homogenous definitions, and it may be full of contradictions, but it's a useful compass. It keeps me on my feet, in the classroom, in the newsroom, on the picket line, in the edit, at the protest, and on this academic panel. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much, Professor Marcella, and thank you so much all for sharing. Now we will head into a 15 to 20 minute-ish conversation between the panelists about the Global South. To get us started, I was thinking I would ask a question for all of our panelists, and then we can probably go from there. My question is about the value in people from the Global South, we just heard Professor Marcella talk about this, but my question is about the value in people from the Global South, leading work from the Global South. And maybe to add to the same point, what could be the differences between someone doing media work or scholarly work that is from the Global South compared to someone doing the same sort of work, but is from, say, the Global North? I want to get started with Professor Banu again, and then we can move to Professor James Horap and then to Professor Marcella.
Thank you, Krishna. That's a very thoughtful question and a good point, a good position to start actually this conversation. And, as Marcella was telling her story, I was inspired, I think we all were, and thinking about our own, personal political existence. There is difference in all of our stories, but there is a commonality. And I think, for example, in the study of political communication or communication as scholarship, I think, there is a place, I think, of this cultural resistance of writing back from the otherized culture. But I think it's also, and we've seen this, previously, colonized societies kind of, flipping the structure, the flow from, periphery to the center. It does happen, asserting your identity. But I think one of the biggest challenges that we face as scholars and intellectuals is to not create these, not kind of confining ourselves into our position as part of the Global South and the thinking. I think we need to keep the difference, but we need to relate to the common patterns of the global world, right? In all of our introductions, we were talking about how this notion of the Global South you know, which has become sort of part of the discourse starting in 2003 when the UN, you know, published this report using the terminology Global South. So it does have a history, obviously, but in academic literature, we would still consider that a little bit of recent history still, right? So hence its popularity. But I think it needs to, we need to have a very, very specific discussion. So this doesn't become, again, what we in academia sometimes experience, you know, a sort of an exercise of the mind. I think we need to be able to connect our local to the common patterns about the neoliberalism, about, you know, the post-colonial, and about globalism in a sense. And I'm just gonna start with this and pass it on to my colleagues.
I guess I'll go. Yeah, I mean, I think your question obviously is very leading in the sense of course, we have to agree with the concept that like having people from the Global South doing work on the Global South is crucial. And that leads, I think, NUQ is in a very interesting position to me, because I think sometimes we get inaccurately kind of embroiled in a conversation about diversity, which doesn't mean kind of globalness, but it kind of means diversity as understood from a very kind of Western notion, which is like a kind of white center, and then like having things around that white center that provide, you know, kind of alternatives to that. And I think that we're in a very interesting place where we don't have to do that. We can imagine a different kind of center, you know, an Arab MENA center, or we can imagine no center at all as kind of a truly kind of global South center. You know, and I can't deny my own positionality, right, in this question, to pretend that like I'm not the white guy from America, you know, studying the Global South, right? Because, you know, you should be asking yourself, like, you know, I do this all the time. I teach African literature and other things. You know, I always start off the class with talking about why you got this white American guy here. How did he come into this? And so I'll save you that that kind of story. But part of it is also not kind of, I think this is part of what Bonnet was getting at, is not kind of pigeonholing people, right? And so for me, yes, we want people from the Global South, but we don't necessarily have to say like, oh, well, you're from Kenya, so you can do the Kenyan thing, or you can do the East African thing, right? What we actually want, when I was telling, you know, that kind of that anecdote about kind of Lebanon and the Nigerian film, was that actually what is much more interesting, and we see this at NUQ, where we have students from all over. And so I'm teaching African literature, and I have students from East Asia and South Asia, and from Africa, and from South America, and from the Middle East, and they all bring a very rich and interesting perspective. So I would love to be training students from South Asia to be Africanist, from Latin America to be Africanist, and, you know, so on and so forth. And so I think that the Global South offers those avenues, instead of just pigeonholing people into like, you must study the thing that you are, which of course is also not a problem. That is quite necessary as well, but I think we're beginning to imagine, you know, something kind of more global.
Yes, a lot of ideas, big ideas. I think that how I would carry on with from what James and Barney are mentioning, I think I would speak from the position of journalism, from a very specific kind of journalism, also my own interest in cultural history. And this is just a kind of an example and an anecdote, which is with regards to this idea of how the South may speak differently than the North for the purposes of this conversation. I once found an archive of newsreels hidden in the Institute of Films of cinema in Cuba, in Havana. The newsreel covered the Institute of Film was the first institution that Fidel Castro set up after the revolution in 1959, 1960, he sets up ICAIC. And in that institution, he dedicated some space to producing a newsreel. Gathered around that newsroom were artists, directors, who produced a newsreel between 1960 to 1990. I think there were 1,593 newsreels. And those newsreels told the history of that period through the eyes of Cuba. So the way that history was inscribed in those newsreels in very basic news form was absolutely a different gaze. You know, it reported on the US and its civil rights. It reported on racism in the US. It reported on the Northern Irish conflict in vocabulary that you would not have got in the British media. It also represented another gaze because these were avant-garde artists who were looking for different kinds of news conventions. These were newsreels that were shown in cinemas and around the islands, but projected in villages that had never seen images, moving images before. So both in terms of the content and the form, this was an example of how the South can produce a different kind of knowledge of the North. And of course, it will be derided today as propaganda, but that would be very short-sighted because these were very critical views and they were playing around with both agitprop, they were playing around with socialist realism, with a Caribbean kind of flavor. I know that Rana, one of my colleagues here, I was very, very interested by the fact that she'd studied in Moscow during the 90s. And these are the things that fascinate me because these are productions of knowledge that come from a different place and they produce a totally different kind of narrative. And they're very rich.
So now we can just say whatever we want.
Yes, that's the format. But if you'd like to end with that question there, I might have another question I can ask you.
I've got a question for Jim.
Yeah, sure.
I've got a question for you because I, you know, we live in a world where we're very much very interested in the notion of facts, in given that we are living this so-called post-truth era. You know, there's a real concern, a serious concern for accurate reporting. But what gets lost sometimes in that could be that the search for truth doesn't necessarily have to depend on the fact. Truth sometimes lies beyond it. And I'm very much interested in literary journalism, which sometimes plays a little bit fast and loose with the truth. You know, we can think about Tom Wolfe, but we can also think about Garcia Marquez. I'm sure there were journalists, stroke writers in Africa that may have done the same thing. I don't know if you could talk, I know that you're interested in graphic novels. Is there something you can talk to us about with regards to kind of an alternative narrative that gets to the truth better than neutral empirical reporting?
Well, you're talking to the right person if you want to hear someone say that literature is more truthful than other forms of scholarship. But as I said in my short opening, I'm biased. So, you know, for example, Colonial Reports. I wrote an article a while back on the 1929 riot. It's called a riot by Colonial Reports of women in southern Nigeria. And essentially, this was a bunch of women who had who like many places in Africa, women were running the markets. British colonial empire decided to tax them, and they weren't having it, and they raised hell, and they ended up killing people, they ended up burning things down, and essentially in the area it was called a war, and then the British kind of called it a riot for reasons that they always do in colonial reports. But the point being that the access to that is through British colonial reports, which I think we can all agree are pretty much like not useful for finding out what happened, right? And so you can read against the grain only so much, right? To kind of take away their bent on whatever is going on. And so there's been fiction about that. And, you know, I think about like the recent Nobel laureate Abdulrazak Gurnah writing about East Africa, and he's writing about kind of the social milieu in East Africa of Black Africans, of South Asians, and of Arabs, And talking about the way that these communities come together in ways that history and journalism can reach in a limited way. But if you actually want to kind of think about like what it was like to be one of those people, to try to inhabit those people, then I think literature does a much better job of that than other disciplines. And so there's, to me, when that's done well, like Gurna, for example, there is as much truth in a novel like Paradise or By the Sea or any of his works as in factual retellings that actually at their core kind of often lack a lot of facts. So we can talk about more contemporary examples because those are kind of examples that are fraught because of the European historical record, but hopefully that answers to some degree what you're asking.
Well, I have a sort of a general thought, a point of discussion, I think, for the panel and maybe for something for the audience to consider as well. Because we were saying, right, this is beyond geography. So we have pockets of the global south and the global north, and then we have the north and the global south and so on. And in my, you know, readings and analysis, I always, you know, I pay attention to these groups and classes. In these societies of the global south who are already part of the transnational economy and its formation and how it works. And thus they have actually a stake at the perpetuation and the expansion of the concept of the global north. What are some of the effective strategies, or what are some of the things that can be done, right, to increase the voice, to increase the representation, but also I think this is this is at grassroots level, at NGO level, at government leadership level. So I was wondering what you guys were thinking. And Krishna, if you have, if you would wanted to add something, that would be welcome as well.
I would let the panelists go, I think, for now.
Well, I would say Marcella should answer that.
Bonnie, I'm going to find it really difficult. I'm not a riffer. I find it difficult to conceptualize. I'm trying to come at this from the experience of journalism, but you've mentioned NGOs and different kinds of grassroots movements. And I think that what I could maybe bring to the table here is that in the past few months, I wanted to step to the side of journalism for a little moment. And I was helping out on the strategic comms of an organization called United Voices of the World. I don't know if some of my students here are with me. United Voices of the World is a grassroots trade union in London. And it is very, very recent. It's very small. And it represents precarious workers, migrants, mostly black and brown. And if there ever was an example of the global south being in the global north, this is one of them. And what was interesting to me is that beyond the structure of journalism, where we have certain rules, what we can and can't say, what we attribute, what we don't, in order to maintain a sense of some kind of neutrality. What's interesting within the context of strategic communications in that organization is that this grassroots movement, moving away from a far more corporate model, in the past 40 years, unions have become incredibly corporate. The narrative and the power is being given to the membership lead. And so the narrative that comes out is not smooth, it's not glamorous, it's not slick. But you can hear the voices. And so when you work in a when you work with these workers, these are pandemic heroes. These are people who've kept the city running, and they are being kept in with inferior terms and conditions than their colleagues within institutions. They're being outsourced by private contractors. And so it's really interesting to think about the global south in those scenarios and how they construct their own messages via WhatsApp, via social media, via Facebook, etc., via posts. It doesn't matter. So I don't know if I've added or responded to your question, but I just wanted to share that experience.
Well, no, the thing is that, you know, when you mention, obviously, you know, WhatsApp or you know, Twitter or any other kind of social media platform, it also brings the realization that these are companies which exist in the global north, right? And the types of practices, for example, in the case of, you know, Facebook here in the US, it was called into action to police the fake news and misinformation, and they took it, you know, somewhat to heart. But in India, they don't do any of that stuff, right? In India, where misinformation, for example, in the latest election was in enormous amount of scale, Facebook decided that they're not going to do any kind of policing or truth or fact checking. So, and this is, you know, an example of India, supposedly one of the, you know, the lions of the global south, but still not able to deal with the global north tech giant.
Yeah, and I also think that part of this is highlighting alternatives. I think this is what kind of Marcella was saying as well, is that, you know, yeah, we are kind of saddled with kind of large behemoth Western, you know, news organizations, social media organizations. But there's also a proliferation of so many other types of publications and blogs and things like that from places. And, you know, and so a lot of times what people think is that all they have are these organizations, and they're not kind of pushed in towards, let's say in my case, you know, kind of African publications, right? And so, you know, we can do this in terms of our scholarship or in terms of activism, but I mean, it can be as little as kind of gesturing to something that is fairly underrepresented. And so, you know, like I have a collection coming out soon, and part of it is, you know, excavating African comics that have been completely covered up outside of Africa. They have not circulated, they have not been embraced. And then comics that are fairly popular in other parts of the world, but kind of get ignored. So I don't think that like my one collection is gonna somehow bring those to the forefront, but in terms of like our own personal ethics, you know, I take it as my responsibility to actually kind of bring those to the forefront, and then, you know, beyond that, you know, I'm not sure where it goes from there.
I'd be tempted to complicate one thing here, which is that on the one hand, it's really important, I think, for spaces. Knowledges to be given spotlights, and for, you know, historiography to redeem things that have been forgotten. But I do think that if we are to think about media and democracy, we also do need to accept the fact that legacy media, therein lies power, an incredible amount of power. So I think that we need to face the fact that one of the struggles is to democratize those spaces. The BBC, for example, is hugely under threat, and the fight is, the battlefield is for the public broadcaster to retain some level of neutrality, and neutrality in the best of senses, in order to stave off privatization, the competition from conglomerates.
Yeah, I know. Krishna wants, hold on just a second. I know Krishna wants to move on to the Q&A, and absolutely. But I think like we can do both, right? Like we can, you know, reform and improve these organizations you're talking about, and try to pivot to others.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. Now we're looking to move into Q&A for the last part. We have about 16 minutes left. And I would turn it over to Clovis to take over for Q&A.
Thank you. Yeah, it's just really hard to interrupt such a, you know, kind of, you know, fascinating and discussion. I think, you know, just want to make sure that we have time to take question and answer from the audience. You know, I think people are able to unmute themselves. So I'm just asking people to either pose their question in the Q&A or to raise their hand. And hopefully, I know there was that interruption and everybody was muted. I think people are still able to unmute. So we'll try. Hope the technology is going to be with us today. It's not been easy as these Zoom things go. But maybe to get us started with the Q&A, I know in the audience, there's a couple of students from NUQ who were research assistants with the Institute over the past semester who've been thinking a lot about the Global South. And I know they wanted to ask questions to the panelists. So maybe they can get us started with a couple of questions and then we'll move on to the audience. I see hands raised already. But I don't know if Augusta or Karam, did you want to jump in?
We promise to keep our responses short so we can get as many people in as possible.
I know this is time is flying by when you're let's see. I'm not sure if people, you know, how easy it is to. Let me see. I see Greg, you have your hand raised. Maybe we can start with you. Are you able to unmute?
Yeah, I think so. Can you hear?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, it was just, I mean, very fascinating. I just love this. And I really want to thank you all. I mean, it's just absolutely fantastic. My concern is both practical and in a way ethical, and I guess in a way quite personal. And I don't want to go into great detail, but you know, I founded an initiative about 22 years ago to support, advance, defend the idea of a public service orientation in media called RIPE. And along about 2012, I began to think, you know, it's a very Eurocentric orientation because of the importance of these institutions like the BBC. And I would like to begin to do something to contribute more in the rest of the world, the wider world, where this orientation has not been part of their heritage, except through some colonial legacy of companies that were essentially created by the British or other colonial powers. And so I began to try to work on this idea of kind of a RIPE related to the Global South. And I now have a group of very good colleagues involved, like Winston Mano from Zimbabwe and Anish Raman from Bangladesh and several others. And we started working on this idea and immediately ran into a couple of real problems, practically speaking. And one that was particularly important for me is like what Jim said earlier. I mean, I'm this white guy from America, and I am conditioned by the normative values and the realities of my experience being born and raised in the United States. Beyond that, I'm also conditioned by my intellectual development, by the things that I've chosen to specialize in, and the values that are part of those ideals and those theories that are part of the public service ethos. And over time, what I've begun to realize is that a lot of this is extremely culturally dependent and largely tacit. It's not something that I'm always very, very aware of. Now, you fast forward into a situation where here I am, stutter, and I want to contribute. I think it would be fair to say that I'm a person of goodwill, and with a PhD in the bigger, wider world, this is a very rare thing to have. There's a unique skill set and knowledge. I want to contribute and so forth, but I've not lived in the places where I might be able to help. I've not lived in the reality emotionally or experientially of the people who are you know, perhaps in these countries where RIPE might be able to do something useful. So my question is really to ask the panel, what do you think about this? I mean, how can or should, I know that's a normative kind of way to put it, but you know, if you think about people like myself, how should we approach or understand our effort to do good? What even is good in this kind of a context, and how do we need to understand that? And of course we can say, well, you know, you take a critical orientation, and I do, but in practical terms, beyond our important intellectual considerations, what do you do and what are the limits?
And if anybody wants to respond to this question now.
Greg, I mean, this made me kind of think about an experience I had very early in my career. So everybody knows I'm from Turkey, I'm from Istanbul. And I probably would be considered a little bit of north in my global south country. And I was very young, just a new PhD, and an Anglo-Saxon gentleman told me that I was not qualified to talk about the issues that women in Turkey are facing because I do not represent them. Of course, at that time, I was shocked and naive, and I couldn't, come back and say, oh, as a white Anglo-Saxon male, you can. Those are the moments, like 20 years later, you're still, I should have said it. But I think the importance here is, something that I may, said in the very beginning, acknowledging the difference, but also looking for the commonality, right? And I think intention, honest intention, I think, is key. It's just like any, ethical intercultural communication issue. That's my 2 cents.
Thank you, Banu. I'm just very conscious of time, and I want to get to some of the questions. I see 3 hands raised, so I'm going to ask people to ask very short questions and hopefully some short answers. This is the first of a series of critical discussions, so hopefully we can continue that, over the next year and further. Let's start. Maybe with you, Heather Jaber, and then if you can keep the question short.
Yes, I will be very fast. Thank you. This is a really wonderful conversation, really exciting. My question was, so you've talked about the Global South as sort of encounters, moments, places, all sorts of things. And I was wondering, at such a unique place like NewQ, where in your day-to-day do you feel the Global South, or where do you come into those contradictions, or what are those encounters for you? So I guess, yeah, what is the Global South in the sort of situated space you're in?
Can I answer that really simply? I come into contact when I arrive at the door and there's a security guard from Kenya. I walk in and there's somebody from the Philippines. I go a little bit further up and there are my compatriots from the north of England and from London too. I go further up, I go around the world. Different classes, different stratifications, loads of contradictions. That's what I've lived in NUQ.
I would just add to that particularly in the classroom, in terms of breadth, absolutely, like everywhere. In terms of depth, for me anyway, the classroom is an amazing space because, in the way that I was talking about kind of Lebanon and Nigeria, in a single classroom, you almost always have students from various places in the Middle East, South Asia, different parts of Africa, South America, and the connections that they're able to make. It's one of the things I say all the time is that it's amazing how our students kind of start out at such an advanced and amazing level because they've already internalized so many of the notions of the Global South and post-colonialism. And unlike when I taught in the US, and I really felt like I had to walk students through, like, was colonialism good or bad? And you have to like start at that kind of basic level. And so here at NUQ, to me, like the depth for me happens a lot in the classroom.
Thank you, Jim. If it's okay with you, Banu, I'm going to move on to the next question so we can maybe get to all of them. Augusta, did you want to ask a question?
Sure. So as Professor Clovis said, I'm one of the research assistants, and my question, I don't know if it's a bit too broad, but then to ask our panelists, according to you, do you think there is a near or far future where the lines drawn between the global north and the global south sort of dissipate? And do you think that would be more, that would even be more beneficial to the current situation, or would it be necessary? So it's a bit packed, but I hope you just.
Go ahead, Marcella.
I'm a socialist.
That's short. Yeah. That also gets to the point. No, I guess.
That was short.
Right, but yeah. Anybody wanted to ask to that? I think important question. Maybe hard to answer in a couple of minutes.
I would just say very briefly, conceptually, absolutely. I mean, part of what I was saying was that what the Global South is kind of all about is questioning, not just moving between borders, but questioning borders themselves, why borders are the way they are, why this is a national border or a linguistic border or something like that. And so ultimately then, of course, that is about problematizing borders, whether those are national borders or north-south borders. In reality, like, are national passports going anywhere? I doubt it.
Thank you.
Well, one very quick sentence. I mean, with this economic model that we have in the world, with the neoliberal practices, I don't see the divide closing.
Thank you. I see Karam, you have your hand raised too. Did you want
to? Yeah, so my question is just from someone who's like trying to make sense out of things. At least, you know, like in the Global South and everything, you said that, you know, it's like Professor Banu said, that it's an imagined transnational community, that is, it's also like a movement that is about delinking from imperial power structures. So there are so many countries in the Global South that that I've seen, at least, that express this anti-imperial rhetoric. And this at times also like gains support from leftist circles. So at least this from my example, like where I've seen, like in Syria, where, you know, the Assad government sometimes is seen as this, you know, fighting force against imperialism. So my question was just that, you know, as people from the Global South and part of the Global South, what do you know, should we dissociate ourselves from, you know, seeming as if we're siding with what is also oppressing us at the same time? And should we even in the first place? Because how do we make sure that, you know, that we're avoiding, you know, falling into like false narratives? So I don't know. I hope it made sense.
That's a good point, Karam. I think the danger there is then just to trapping yourself even further in that definition, right? I think that's what you are trying to get at. When you look into the existing literature on the Global South, that's one of the things that a lot of scholars are actually pointing towards, to be aware that this imagined transnational community exists, but then also becoming a silo in itself as well. But I also think what is important to consider here is that the variations that we have within the Global South, let's say, for example, again, I'm going to bring a very brief example from Turkey. Turkey sees itself as a contender, right? It doesn't really consider itself, when these kinds of questions of Global South are not even part of the discussion in Turkey's political reality. They kind of see themselves as a North acting towards the Middle East and the Muslim community. So there is a lot of nuance.
Thank you. I think we have time for one, final question. I see your hand raised, Alfonso, if you want to maybe jump in now, and then I might just go over a couple of minutes, but it's...
Great. Thank you so much. And a belated congratulations to the Institute on its launch. I follow the dean on Twitter, and that's how I heard about today. My question for the panelists, particularly I think for panelist Marcella, is how do we change the dynamic and the perception of the Global South? And we're lucky today to hear from you with your experience working at Al Jazeera, which is a really good example of how to empower and amplify voices from the South. And I'm curious as to if other models, if you think they'll work, like when I think of out of Turkey, TRT World, or CGTN, or even Arise TV out of Africa. I'm based in Abidjan. And those questions for you, I come from the context of, I'm one of those folks who actually went from network journalism into development communications, back into network journalism, and now I'm based in Africa working on development communications and trying to amplify voices. Do you think that these other channels, TRT World, CGTN, Arise, can help change that perception and change the narrative of the Global South? Thank you.
Thank you, Alfonso. It's a great question. We have little time, so I would just say that it's very, I think that it's easy to sniff at some of these outlets that you've mentioned. It's easy to indeed ridicule. I mean, you mentioned RT. These are outlets that have got their, Telesur is another one, right? Telesur is the Venezuelan outlet that I'm sure some of my colleagues here may not appreciate, but they are attempts to avoid or trying to bypass cosmopolitan centers in order to produce their own forms of knowledge. And I think they're important. And I think that viewers, I would just deflect this a little bit and say that audiences, it's our jobs as educators to, and educators and journalists to make sure that audiences can navigate and consume news from the multiplicity of choices that they have in order to come somewhere near the truth. And I think that all of those kinds of channels do help to do that. It's a really tough question because I think that the model of journalism today, as we always say, is in crisis. And I don't think that we should underestimate the importance of media, of big media, legacy media outlets. They're important, they've got power. And so these other global channels are important. I hope I came somewhere near answering your question.
So I think we're a couple of minutes over time, and I know we all have a lot of things to get to in this this difficult time. So I want to just thank the panelists for their contribution, Krishna Sharma for his moderating. Please join me in I know it's hard to applaud on Zoom, but thank you so much for your contribution and for leaving us with so many things to think about. And until I said, this is the first of a series of critical conversations on the notion of the Global South. So we look forward to seeing everyone, again, and continuing some of the conversations from today.